real? What's deception? What should we be paying any attention to? What is it that's driving us insane?
He knew the world would not be the same.
Something happening here.
Truth Connection.
The Outer Space Security and Development Treaty of 2012. That international document that will be signed into law has acknowledged the reality of the cosmos cultures and the indigenous cultures who are in this treaty. People who tell the truth are often a threat. This treaty establishes a framework and procedures that will assure that space will be a neutral realm from which all classes of weapons are banned, they're outlawed, and from which no hostile action shall take place towards the Earth or the surrounding cosmos. Can anybody that we're talking to right now disagree with that? I hope not. We have military people who have gone public with the fact that they too have sat down with extraterrestrial beings, and again, none of them are hostile. There is no evidence of hostility. We can ban space-based weapons, invite them in officially. People are working on landing pads in different parts of the world. There's a lot of really great stuff happening. Space-based weapons, and specific ones, are a dumb, dangerous, destabilizing, too costly, unnecessary, untestable, unworkable idea. The best of the people I've ever met, the most conscious, the most heartfelt, the ones who know that we are a love vibration and we can be living on a garden paradise planet. I just want to cry when I say all this. We can have self-sustained communities, a different kind of economic system, a security system that's based on cooperation and sharing of information and connecting and hugging each other. Between space-based weapons or all kinds of things that would be space-based that would allow for future generations to have a future. And in fact, at this point, they don't have much of one unless we do make these changes. That's what this treaty's about. If we could say to ourselves, look, what is it that we can actually do to change the game, to get into a frequency that space age, that the ETs are in, that's based on, dare I say it, love,
Good evening and welcome to another edition of Truth Connections Radio. We are very happy that you're here tonight listening live in the audience or in our archives at blogtalkradio.com or at our YouTube channel. We really appreciate you coming back. At this time, I'm going to bring on my co-host, Rand Porter. Hey, Rand, you there?
Hey, Kathy. How you doing?
I'm doing great. We have a great show tonight. Very excited.
Yes, we do.
This guest we have this evening has had a front row seat and access to many government military facilities and involvement with top secret projects and development over the years. She has also been a key player in the Disclosure Project and is an award-winning educator, has been involved heavily in the aerospace industry, spokesperson for Dr. Wernher von Braun, who was also dubbed the father of rocketry, the founder of ISCOS, the Institute for Security and Cooperation in Outer Space, is the co-author of the Outer Space Security and Development Treaty of 2012, and a complete humanitarian that has an agenda on raising consciousness and frequency of humanity. She's a cosmic warrior for peace on Earth, as well as the multiverses. Please allow me to welcome Dr. Carol Rosin. How are you, Carol?
Oh, after hearing that beginning and your introduction, I'm doing fine. I feel good, and I really want to cry after listening to that song that's called The Last Card, that introduction that you played. That music was written by an American Indian, a Native American Indian named James Makwabit. And to have my words put into that, my message, I feel like I can go home now. Could you just keep playing that over and over?
Yes, and I could honestly list your accomplishments for another half an hour. It would be easy to do. We've never had a guest who has inspired so much music and artwork. So that's saying something, that you're moving people on a creative level, because it's definitely next to consciousness.
Oh, thanks so much. It's been quite a journey, and I'm glad to be here with you. I'm not doing very many interviews this year, just a little handful, and only one speech. That's the one for Paula Harris that's going to be May 17th weekend in Texas that people can find out about at starworksusa.com, because I've come to the conclusion after this long journey that it's time to actually get something really important done, or we're screwed. So we really have a lot of work to do, and it's very positive, and it's feasible, but it is definitely work. And I look forward to talking with you about all of this and the possibilities, the vision that is real. It's not La La Land, and it can be depressing if you look at it from the other side of it, the part that if we don't get it done, the consequences are just unspeakable. I think most people could probably give that part of the talk. But this is a new way out of this mess that I'm so happy that you've invited me on. Thank you both so much.
We are completely honored to have you, Carol. And honestly, it's a pleasure and an honor to have you here. And if you would, since we're on that topic, why don't you go ahead and I will put the link in the chat box for the Blog Talk listeners about where they can find information on the space treaty.
Yes, thank you. The website that we have up, actually, it was done about a year ago by a lady in Australia, Leah Shanley, who took it over, and I'm about to update it. But you can download the treaty in several languages. If anybody can do it in Russian, we're missing that one. We need it. And it's called the Outer Space Security and Development Treaty, as you said. And it's just extraordinary. It's on the website peaceinspace.com, P-E-A-C-E-I-N-S-P-A-C-E, peaceinspace.com. And this treaty was co-authored by the most amazing men. In fact, this whole group of people that are making contact, and I don't want to start a movement, so I've already gotten a few thousand emails. What I really now want to do is hope that everybody listening will go to this website and read it, look in the About Us section, and read the bios of the five men that co-authored it with me. You'll be as impressed as I am with their distinguished credentials. They're courageous men with high-level credentials in the revolving door game, the military-industrial lab, university, NASA, and other international space agencies, government-governments complex, I call it. We'll shorten it to the military-industrial complex, but it really is quite broad. And the Treaty on peaceinspace.com is the first one to ever acknowledge the indigenous cultures, the wisdom and the nature, harmony with nature, the indigenous cultures, and the cosmos cultures. So this has been quite a step, a leap for a lot of us in the industry. We suffer for it sometimes, but we're at the point now, especially the people on this website, who are, and many others, who are willing to now tell the truth without the spin, because none of the ETs are hostile. That's one of the messages that we're going to get across in this treaty. And it's a real treaty, but it tells a story. It's not like the end of it kind of sounds like legalese, but the whole nut of the treaty is so fascinating. It reads like a very interesting but realistic book. It could be a science fiction story in itself, except that it's real.
It's very well done.
Thank you.
And I know that you have some people co-found that with you, co-write that with you. Didn't Edgar Mitchell start that, or was
yes,
that?
And Edgar Mitchell, probably a lot of your listeners know who that is. He's an astronaut, engineer, former U.S. Navy captain, a test pilot, and NASA Apollo astronaut. He was the sixth man to walk on the moon, and he's the astronaut who had an out-of-body experience in space and founded the Institute of Noetic Sciences in 1973-4, when I founded my institute, too. And he has been dedicated ever since his experiences as an astronaut and all that went with it to exploring consciousness and to raising human potential, implementing all kinds of societal alternatives and pursuing strategies for a sustainable future, which, again, is what this treaty is all about. And he's one of the five men that I worked with on this, and Edgar's been my advisor for over four decades. He's just amazing. But what's really interesting to me about him, besides his credentials and his experiences, is that he years ago advised me, and neither one of us would, to not talk about extraterrestrial beings, cosmos, cultures. And now he's, I think, the most outspoken astronaut on this issue and is just telling the truth. And it turns out he was born in Roswell, New Mexico, of all places. So he's just fascinating. And working with him, with Commander Will Miller, who is also a retired U.S. Navy officer, decorated veteran, and he's working with Rotary Clubs right now to try to educate them and also to be in service with them. And he's a former advisor to the U.S. Space Command, the Department of Defense, White House staff. He's a senior analyst in counter-threat planning. And he was a senior technology support officer with the U.S. Atlantic Command. He served as on the advisory board of my institute as well. And he's been an advisor, too, to people like Dr. Stephen Greer, who founded the Disclosure Project, Leslie Kane, who has a best-selling book out on the UFO issue, and a journalist. He's just amazing. And Abe Krieger, former Boeing structural engineer and a business developer manager for, I think, 37 years at Boeing. And he was the head of the International Space Station program, too, the Russian part of the Space Cooperation program, and was a manager of global nuclear spent fuel storage and logistics feasibility studies. He's quite a strategist, and he's been working with me on the strategy, too, of how to get this treaty signed, and he also helped co-author it. He's absolutely extraordinary that as a retired executive now, he wasn't when I met him. I met him, by the way, in an audience that I used to call the 600 Greatest Hawks in America that the U.S. Space Foundation gives a conference. It always looks like a war expo to me, but it's supposed to be about a space technology. That's where I met him. I think he was quite skeptical of me until we sat down and talked in a very thoughtful. He's a very deep, thoughtful man. And two others that you all probably know now of, the Honorable Paul Hellyer, who is the former Minister of Defense in Canada, who oversaw the integration of armed services into the Canadian forces. And he's quite, he's also an aeronautical engineer. He's written several books that are absolutely incredible. One I just finished reading was Goodbye Canada. You know, it's a compromise. And one now that he has on the economics of the world that's just extraordinary, Paul Hellyer. These guys are, their bios, by the way, and contact information are all on that peaceandspace.com website. And he's quite an advocate now for global UFO disclosure. I mean, to have a former Minister of Defense introducing this treaty and co-authoring it too. And he introduced the first treaty that was companion to a bill that didn't go anywhere. It wasn't as good as this treaty, but he introduced it in Canada. Very, very, one of the most courageous men on the planet. And finally, Dr. Scott Jones. And he is a retired U.S. Navy commander. His background is in overseas and national intelligence. He's an intelligence service guy. And Dr. Jones founded the Peace and Emergency Action Coalition for Earth. Now, feature an intelligence agent sort of person who I met when he was senior advisor to Senator Claiborne Pell, who was the first senator to invite me to testify before the U.S. Senate Armed Services Committee. I don't even know that they ever had a woman before, because he was very concerned about what my hair and my clothes would look like. So, you know, they, women addressing that group. But anyway, he's absolutely brilliant, extraordinary, metaphysical. His intelligence is based on a very high-level spiritual base and frequency. And I just love all of these men. And this man founded something that has the acronym, the initials Peace, Inc., P-E-A-C-E, Inc. Again, the Peace and Emergency Action Coalition for Earth. The website for that one is peaceroom.com. He oversees the development, he oversaw the development of the Center for Sustainable Peace and Development, too. And he, too, encourages dialogue among leaders, world leaders, about UFO disclosure. And he also is on the board of the Exopolitics Institute that I'm on the advisory board of, too, and where Paula Harris is very involved as a professor with Michael Sala, who founded it. And so Scott Jones is working on the UFO disclosure in a very heavy-duty way, traveling internationally to countries and fitting in the benefits, the meaning of what the cosmos cultures are from a historic viewpoint to the current and futuristic one. Just amazing humans. And I've had the 501c3 now, thanks to him. So the treaty is now a project of Peace Inc. And Gary Davis of the World Government of World Citizens, you probably know, he's fabulous. He has a new radio show that's about to come out too. I'll get you the address for that. Gary just sent me my new world passport, ID card, birth certificate, stuff that I've been using for years as my identification, actually. And I'm using the consultant title on my identification now as consultant to the Peace and Emergency Action Coalition for Earth. I love it.
Yes, we do too. And that was a long list of extremely accredited individuals who should be taken very seriously, because this is a very serious topic. There's no turning back, and we need to make sure that they do not weaponize space.
Well, if they do, it will be an extension of what's going on the Earth. It certainly doesn't take it away from Earth, but imagine the brain and money drain that go along with this and the dangers. I mean, I've testified and spoken for so many years, Kathy, about how it's a dumb, dangerous, destabilizing, too costly, unnecessary, unworkable, undesirable idea. You can tell I've said that a few times. And also, because it's undesirable, what are the alternatives? And I think that's what most of us don't know so much about. Most people now are, and rightly so, more concerned about their own survival. This is a world, a time of survival needs.
And that's not a mistake.
No.
It's all part of the distraction.
Yeah, exactly. And they're doing a very good job of presenting the distraction to us and involving us all in it. Fortunately, more and more people are awakening to it, and what we're going to do with the treaty is those who get tapped by it, just see who might want to work on some part of it, and during this talk today, I can tell you about some of the people in different countries who are working on various aspects. It's different in each country. There are different needs in each country. I'm kind of circumventing the U.S. at the moment. You may have noticed what a mess we're in.
Yes.
And, I mean, listening to these candidates, I'll be glad to talk about that, too. I won't be glad to, but I will talk about it more. Because it's just so ridiculous. It's a bad cosmic rubber crutch joke.
It's all a big old dog and pony show, I always say.
Oh, yes. This is the biggest. And so the stakes are very high now. They're higher than ever to not have a ban on space-based weapons, because that is the continuation of the old paradigm, the old war game. And, of course, it's all based on money, domination, and control. And I add on to that that it's run by some Armageddonites. You know, this is a religious fanaticism that's going on, too.
Very important part of the equation, yes.
And this treaty lifts people out of it. I mean, I've been getting – it's the first time I've had so many – I have a biography that isn't written in my bio of people who have said I'm either a Nazi, a CIA agent, an FBI agent, an agent of the military-industrial complex, or I sell real estate ripping off little old ladies. I mean, people make up these stories.
No way.
Try to discredit. It's nothing new.
Absolutely.
It's part of the discrediting campaign.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's okay. It's part of it. And fortunately, I've come out the other end of some attacks, and now it's after getting a little post-traumatic stress over some things that happened along the way, it's starting to be almost funny and more pathetic. It's just pathetic. And what I've learned to do is, and it's sad because I'm basically I used to be all inclusive. Now I basically am walking away from toxic energy, toxic people. And I just want to work with the people who are willing to put some serious work into getting this treaty signed, because it will change the entire game. And this is the last rung of the ladder on this one. And we're really going for this in a very serious way, but with a kind of warped sense of humor. And some people, like the ones who have written music, 5 songs have come in, as well as James. I think you're going to play one of them by this wonderful young woman in Denmark, Pia Elizabeth Larsen,
yes, we are.
Who wrote 3 songs and a 4th one coming along. So, and I'll be glad to send people the links to these. I'm going to put them on the website eventually. But for now, if anybody goes to the website, peaceandspace.com, my email address is on there, which is spacetreaty@gmail.com. I'll be glad to send links to these, the music, because I think one of the ways of reaching people with these very serious issues, but more leaning towards the solutions, is if we can draw the vision through the arts.
It's very much connected to consciousness. And I just want to back up for just a moment and say that on your Space Treaty website, it's downloadable in 8 languages. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you mentioned what you did about having it translated in Russia, because our show, I looked at our YouTube stats, and our show is viewed in a lot of countries that it's possible for a show to be viewed in these days. And I want to put the call out there to anyone who speaks another language to partner up with you and try to translate it so others can know exactly what it says too, because there's a lot of other, you know, indigenous or small type of languages that aren't used that often that might, you know, benefit from knowing what it says.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Yeah,
the
languages that it's translated into are people who kind of got fed up with me because I had originally put up the little flags from Google Translate. I use Google Translate to actually talk with people around the world, and that does work for that. It's pretty simple. But the treaty had words in it that were just terrible, apparently. So people have very kindly been sending me the correct and proper translations in different languages. So thanks for that call. Anybody that's international, a world citizen, that can translate it into more languages, yes, please send it off to me at spacetreaty@gmail.com. You can get it right through the website. And it actually brings people into this higher state of language. Oh, by the way, there's even a 5th song talking about higher. It's almost like a psychedelic song. Again, these are people that I met on Facebook. And this one is written by Ben Zulu, and he goes by Purple Gypsy Sun. And his is a psychedelic song, too, that I love to send to people that is just fabulous. And the languages, that is a language of a generation. And the languages from around the world are so important to break through and learn. You know, in the States, we're pretty ignorant, most of us, that we don't learn a lot of languages, don't seem to need to. But I have such a high respect for different cultures, and I think having the languages up there is also symbolic of the respect that we need to have for different cultures and languages and perspectives, because that's what we have to reach in order to communicate with the off-planet cultures, of which there are many. And again, none of them are hostile. We're still here, and in spite of all the rumors and lies and disinformation spun, that's the fact. So one of the facts is that we're starting to destroy cultures, whoever it is that's going into these places and beating down doors and killing and causing suffering and maiming and raping and so on.
The rainforest is just horrible.
Oh, my gosh. Yes. And even our indigenous president in Bolivia, I'm working with the Bolivians, and we do intend to have President Morales sign this because he's our only indigenous president on the planet. But even he, somehow, he's being protested. April 25th, what's today's date that we're doing this? April 3rd, 2012, it will be another protest march against this wonderful man who suddenly wants to build a road through a rainforest in Bolivia. I mean, no way. So the people who elected him are not too happy with him, and that seems to be pretty obviously the state of the world, looking at our representatives that we've elected. And we're looking for new ones. And what we plan to do with this treaty is get it into the hands. We only need 9 presidents of countries to sign this to make it law. And I'll go over a little bit more of the details as we talk during the next couple of hours of this, because it's fascinating what's in this treaty. But what we plan to do, and with the help of the people, the listeners now, the serious people, is get it into the hands of their leaders all around the world. And the first 9 who sign this will enforce this into law. It turns into a law like the Outer Space Treaty of 67 was, which is now dead. And this treaty incorporates the best of previous treaties, of proposed ones like the Russian-China one, which has been stuck in the conference committee for too many years at the UN. That's why we're going outside and doing it ourselves, in the context of a new paradigm that we can get something done ourselves. We can. So we're going to get this into the hands of the first 9 world leaders. And I just talked with a wonderful woman, Claudine Johnson, a documentarian. Her 2-people team are going to travel with us and interview everyone who participates in getting this into the hands of the presidents, prime ministers, kings, queens, whoever the leaders are that are signatories to a treaty in each man-made boundary we call a country. And we're going to turn this into a law. Hopefully we can get this done in 2012. It all depends on how many people can contribute to buying our plane tickets and hotel rooms. That's really one of the calls that we were about to put on the website, because it obviously takes money. And we've all been volunteers for so many decades that we have to do this with, you know, somebody out there has a checkbook or a credit card and will say, I know it, that I will get you those tickets. And there will be 4 of us so far, one or the 2-people documentary team. And one is Counselor Tamsin Williams, a lawyer in the UK. She and her mother, who is an international lawyer, have been working on the legal elements of this treaty. And Tamsin, a single mom, is going to go with me too. It'd be wonderful to have a lawyer with us. And we're going to make an appointment and go to these world leaders. We have a couple that we're planning on going to see. I won't mention until we get this actually confirmed within the month of April. And then I have a Paulus conference in mid-May in Texas, which, again, people can go to at starworksusa.com. And we're going to have a wonderful, relatively small gathering. I heard it was going to be somewhere around 100 people, so we have time to be intimate, discuss plans, strategize, see who's interested in working on this. And they're all women speakers who have each of them have a different project and perspective to present at that. It's going to be a lot of fun at that one.
Sounds like it. I just want to tell everybody that's listening, you don't have to be a world leader or a leader in the disclosure of all of this peace treaty. You can be a normal person and write these people who have the power that can make a difference and be one of those 9 leaders that sign this treaty, and call them, write them, interrupt them while they're having dinner. Now is the time not to be shy.
Oh, absolutely. Get on the street, meet them getting into their limos, you know.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I have this enormous, I don't want anybody to feel intimidated when they look at this ridiculous bio of mine, because really I was a 6th grade school teacher who got sucked into an aerospace company because I was pretending with my students that we were pretending we were living and working in outer space for a teaching unit. And these were pretty rambunctious kids. That one broke the toe of one of their 6th grade school teachers, and the other teacher ran out of the school. And one day I was stuck with 90 students. And I remember saying, look, it's you and me, pizza on Fridays. I'll bring in my puppy and we'll put her in my desk drawer. And if you don't tell on me, I won't tell on you. And we'll have bubble gum on Thursdays. But what do you want to, how do you want to learn? Here's what I have to teach you this year. And how do you want to learn it? And one of the children in my 6th grade classroom, a big kid, he had failed a couple of years, stood up and said, I want to get the F off the planet. That's what I want to do. And I went, oh, great, great idea. Well, by the time we had finished that discussion, we had moved our chairs around the classroom, set it up like a space habitat, when the principal walked into the room, he was decontaminated at the door with a hairdryer because he was obviously an extraterrestrial and we didn't know what kind of germs he carried. And every day for the rest of that year, in fact, for the next couple of years, I was pretending with my classrooms to be living and working in space. And one year it hit the press, students studying on spaceship Earth. And it failed to say it was a classroom. It was totally bizarre.
And this was in the 70s, mind you.
Oh, yeah. This was early 74 in the days of equal opportunity, EEOC, when people had to hire women. And here I was talking about outer space.
Poised and ready.
And I got invited up to this industry. I remember saying to my classroom, look, if you were offered a job, we had only been at that time to a chocolate bar factory on a field trip. I mean, I had never been in an industry. I didn't know what a chamber of commerce was. And so there I was going into the industry to explain to them what I had done and why these teachers were writing to Fairchild Industry saying they wanted to either launch their classroom or become pen pals. It was just a real fluke.
I can't think of a better way for the Cliff Notes of dealing with all of those egos from the powers that be than dealing with a bunch of adolescent teens. It gave you a good view of what you had to deal with. I'm sure it helped you.
Yeah, now that you've mentioned it, actually, I think that's where I got my practice.
It is. It has to be.
Get the message. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, isn't this war game like a bunch of little kids? You know, and
yes.
You just give them something else to do, which is what we're talking about here with the ETs landing and with a whole industry that can be transformed into some magnificent projects that will, this is the plan, that we will transform the whole game. And I got it from these children. I mean, they were talking about how to actually run their own lives because we're living on our own space habitat. So first we had to develop Earth observation. And that was our very first lesson, was how to write letters to the world leaders. And I think that's what attracted the attention to begin with. And here, now we have satellites that are communication satellites that allow us, look what we're doing. We're communicating around the world. You have your own radio show. I'm on it. And who knows out there who's listening who will say, look, I'm going to help you get to the leader of Brazil. I mean, we don't know. And it's all from starting out with these satellites that either now they are being used as force multipliers aiming weapons in war games right now and drones and so on, mind control technology, which is what got me out of the industry. That's the part that scared me the most, what they're planning on putting into space to dominate and control our minds. Oh, my God. But these children were just so open, and they were into telepathy. And how do we communicate with an extraterrestrial being? I have now, as you may have heard, gone public with one experience of many that I've had, because there was another man in the room with me when some ETs came in walking through a wall and I had a conversation. Boy, that discredits me from being able to address some audiences. But that is exactly what happened. And so communication, education, Earth observation, global safety systems, as we aim these satellites down to Earth. I can explain all of this in much more detail. All the life sciences that we learn about, all the healing techniques from the humans who have been living and working in space already, the space station, means I think it's 16 countries, less than 20, have already been working on that together. Even countries that are on Earth, they look like they're adversaries, they're enemies, supposedly. But here they are working together in space off the planet. Cosmonauts have told me they absolutely cannot be enemies in space. It would just be too funny because they laugh. I mean, here they are off the planet floating around. I mean, give me a break. And so we're going to explore space, or we're going to do it with weapons. And that will limit us, and that will very likely obliterate, the human species. I hate to get into the depressive part of the consequence.
Yes, but it's a necessary part to discuss. It shows how serious this is.
Yes,
and really, those kids were very lucky to have a teacher that let them kick the box open and get out of that box.
Really,
I'm
lucky.
Sure they value you to this day.
I think teachers and secretaries ought to run the world, actually. I think that's who runs the world. And I think people who are working with children and who are working in healing fields have a tremendous obligation right now. I mean, there are 500 million orphans plus on the planet right now from war and disease. So having children, to me, unless somebody's got an ego and has to look at a genetic pool that looks like them, for heaven's sake, adopt some children. And it's just a very, very sad state now for children. Many of them are just drugged out, and I'm not even opposed to some of the good high drugs that help us see through walls and what our brain is. let me learn. You know, don't forget I launched Timothy Leary's Ashes.
Yes, and a couple other people you hung out with that were expanded mind thinkers as well.
Oh, yeah. I would never have gotten into that, but somebody took me to meet Timothy back in the 60s, and I remember Timothy kind of patting me on the head, saying something like, oh, isn't she cute? Take this little piece of paper and put this on your tongue. You're a teacher. You know, just it won't hurt you. 3 days later, I woke up at that mansion, and wow, what I saw that the mind was capable of doing. And it's extraordinary how much we're capable of doing that we don't do. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so excited about getting this treaty to ban space-based weapons, because that's what's doable. Forget the parts on Earth. That's already just too embedded, and we're not going to be able to just get rid of nukes, because they're going to use nukes in space unless we change the mindset. And that's what this treaty introduces, what's possible to do. And one of the things that's possible to do that, fortunately, I learned by default from Timothy and his friends, is that we can do amazing things with our minds. Now, imagine what these off-planet cultures who are clearly here visiting, have been here, we're part of, and it's just so stupid to not acknowledge them from my viewpoint, but it's so dangerous to acknowledge them from the viewpoint of the people who want to maintain the status quo and more, completely control us all. Imagine how they are traveling and they're not using fossil fuels, and how they are communicating and they're not picking up a telephone. And by the way, my first speech that I gave for Wernher von Braun, when I first went into that aerospace industry, and he told me, he didn't ask me, he told me that I was going to come to Fairchild and I was going to listen to him, and that he wasn't going to die like everybody there was saying he was. Within 3 to 6 weeks, maybe he would be dead. He had a serious case of cancer. He assured me, this part's a little emotional.
That's okay.
He assured me that he was going to live for a few more years or whatever it would take to teach me about the real game, because I was just playing one in my sixth grade classroom, pretending to be in space with my kids. And he said, no, I'm going to teach you. And my first speech for him, because he was too sick to go, was in, let me think, July 74 at the National Education Association. He figured I was qualified because I was an educator. What I didn't know until I got to Chicago, McCormick Hall, was that there were 18,000 people in that room. And the only speech I had given was at a PTA meeting, and I had actually rehearsed it in the mirror the night before about mustard being squirted in the cafeteria. And now I was addressing 1,000 people representing Wernher von Braun, and he said, don't worry, I'll call you. So I got up to the podium and looked for the call, because I was to introduce the first live satellite demonstration to educators to show them how satellites can be used as a teaching tool. And I looked for this phone, and there was no phone. There was my face on this little screen that was on a giant screen behind me, and I had to put my hand over it. I just couldn't look at myself. And now I'm looking, and all I had were some notes on a little pink index cards from some papers and books he told me to read the night before I got on the plane. And then there was no light on the podium. I couldn't see. There was no telephone. And so I just started talking, making up what global education was about. I don't even know how. And suddenly he came into my left ear with no technology in my ear, Catherine, none. And he was transmitting it from another part of the world, of the country rather, wherever he was. And I was now talking about CU-band and K-band, explaining this satellite educational tool. And then someone in the Fiji Islands hit the wrong button. It was a live demonstration, and this guy completely freaked out that he was even doing this. And he hit the wrong button. Now, I was supposed to be able to just let this live demonstration happen. I think it was in 3 countries. And it came to a screeching halt, and I had to give a speech for the next 35 minutes. And there was von Braun in my ear like there was a telephone. Now, explain that one. Well,
of it.
Yeah. I mean, now many people know how to do that kind of communication, remote viewing, all sorts of things. And children are not learning this in the schools. And they know that there's more to what they're capable of doing. If they don't know it innately, they know it from watching TV and getting on the internet. I mean, kids are so much smarter than most of us were at that age.
Especially the young ones, the real young ones. They have no boundaries, and I love it.
Oh, exactly. I met a three-year-old that's programming computers.
Oh, my Lord.
Yeah, and in India, there's a fellow who's put computers in the walls of buildings so that the kids can go up and actually get online. There's so much technology, so many, many. I could list zillions of projects for educators that are going on around the world and in the U.S. too, that there's a lot of advancement that's happening. And musicians are getting involved, theater people. You know, this group Blue is setting up a whole educational system that I could have created myself for a creative way of teaching in schools. Blue is that group that I saw on the stage in Las Vegas. They're completely covered in blue. And when the lights go out, you just see them floating around on the stage. Actually, of course, they're being lifted by their cohorts, but you don't see that part. And I think education now is going to be so creative. We have so many ways of doing it. And that's what's happening in the field of education, except that we're not getting very much information.
Yes. The younger generation of teachers, too, and some of the older ones, are shifting the consciousness in effort to help the children learn and be outside-the-box thinkers as well. I'm very grateful with my daughter's teacher. She's incredible. I can't ask for a better teacher. Teachers deserve a lot of respect.
They really do. And the most creative teachers that I've seen now in my travels are the ones that actually they feed on the children's energy, all ages, when I say children, too.
How can you not? It's so electric.
Yeah, exactly. And they're so, like you're saying and alluding to, too, they're so much more tuned into technology than we were. I mean, I went out of the country for 4 years, 3.5 years ago, which I'm glad I had the experience, but I'm even more glad to be back in the States because the grass is not greener somewhere else. That's another whole story. A lot of us thought we could escape and find some other place, and it's very different in other places, not quite what I thought.
You suffered a great deal, Carol.
It was another home. That was something else. You can't hide anymore. Mm-mm. And you can be where you're from and create something new based on what exists, but just leapfrog over the crap that's out there. There's a lot of negative stuff, but there's more positive that can be done right now. I mean, don't we all know that in the middle of the worst situations are where there's so much room for creativity? And that sounds like some trite, stupid sentence, but actually it's true. It's where opportunity is. And I mean, we're going in the middle of a war zone that's all over this planet to take this treaty to the world leaders. And here many of us are talking about off-planet cultures in the middle of all the struggle and the suffering on the planet that's going on and the possible natural or man-made disasters that could be happening anytime to any of us. So I see great opportunity, and I think education is a key to all of it, and I don't just mean for the children. What are we watching on TV? I'm watching Link TV, Free Speech TV. I think those are the only channels. And the documentary channel, once in a while the History Channel, but it's got some stuff in it that also is just myth and theories and guesses. But a lot of the documentaries are just so fascinating what's actually going on this planet. So Link TV and Free Speech TV, though, have Democracy Now! I'm glued to that show every day. And if I miss it, I go to democracynow.org. Amy Goodman, who hosts it with a couple of other wonderful people. In fact, I named my new puppy Amy after Amy Goodman. A lady on Facebook that I don't know, Kitty Kirtland, sent me from Nashville, Tennessee, driven across the country to Oregon, two poodle puppies. And I thought I couldn't handle two, so I gave one away, and now it's back in my arms. So I have two little poodle puppies as a gift. Here.
Aww.
I mean, people are so generous and giving around this planet, and that's the heart. We need to get back to the spiritual awareness of who we are, and that's what this issue, this space and the off-planet culture issue, taps us with. It's
being kind and loving shouldn't feel awkward to people.
No,
it should feel normal.
And I think people all over the world feel it, but you have this small group in the complex that we allow to run us. I mean, Gary Davis really has such a great idea because he talks about world government and the New World Order, but there are people that are against the New World Order. Of course, the one that they're talking about is one we don't want, but within that structure is a lot of conspiracy theory, a lot of myths, theories, opinions, perspectives, interpretations, and then perspectives and interpretations of people's perspectives and interpretations that are passed through footnotes as though they're research. And it sells a lot of books because it also brings up a lot of fear. And, you know, there are a lot of egos and a lot of this is an ego-based human species. And it's a fear-based, therefore, human species. And to be able to raise out of the lower level of that ego state into a higher state, for just lack of a language, because it isn't religious when I say spiritual or soul or heart, something that is the nature of the human species is that love frequency. And when we get into that, it's a healing energy. And all of us know, we all, if you find somebody that doesn't need to be healed from something that's gone on in their life, I'd like to meet those people.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, I've met so many people around the world that are really suffering, and the destruction that's taking place, and then, of course, the contractor's going to clean it up. That's the other part of the story. But the people that are suffering, it's just so unfair. And if you watch news like Democracy Now! And if you watch Link TV, you get Mosaic and Al Jazeera. You get the international real news, not the talking heads and the, you know, the jokesters on the other, you know, supposedly mainstream channels, or the gossip, you know, following whatever the tragedy is of the day.
The mannequins who read off the teleprompter.
Yeah, yeah. And how we got into this mess, I don't know. I mean, Ted Turner was a friend of mine years ago, and I used to travel around with him to different countries when he was setting up CNN. I learned how a lot of that happened, and he was so great. I don't know what happened at these stations now. I mean, I don't want to go into the whole media story, but I think all of us know what's happening to us. And I really want to encourage people to find, if you get cable, I don't think you get it, but you can get Democracy Now! To start, and Link TV. You can go right to the websites and find out how to watch it or read the transcripts from the shows, because a lot of it gets transcribed on the computer, or it's on the radio. Find out what radio stations these shows are on that are alternative news in a very intelligent way. They're not conspiracy-oriented. They're just plain facts with visuals, with footage that you do not see on CNN or Fox or NBC, ABC, or any of the major networks. You do not see this news. Every morning, I try to watch the Democracy Now! During the day, in the background, I switch from Link TV, that channel, to Free Speech. I just go back and forth, and there are probably others, but these are the ones I became familiar with when I got back from that other country that we had another whole situation with, again, because it's impossible to hide from what you get exposed to. When you travel, is how this old paradigm has spread around the planet. What it does, I think, for people like us, I mean, you and Rand included, you know, running this show, is it inspires us to produce more. And I think that's the human spirit. And if we in the United States, which is where a lot of this war stuff emanates from, sadly, and where the leadership has just, we were so delusional. I'm in a state of delusion anyway from what President Obama hasn't done yet. But then, can you imagine the other ones getting elected, any of them?
Well, honestly, you're the person who deserves a Nobel Peace Prize, and they should strip him of his yesterday.
Oh, my God.
He did nothing to deserve it.
It's really sad, isn't it? What's happened now, because he really sold out on us. He just did. And I hope that people can reach him. I'd like to go reach him.
I have to admit, I voted for him, but he's not. I'm not going to vote for him again. That's for darn sure.
Well, the problem is, if you don't, you might get... Somebody wrote me a note today, and I don't mean to make a flippant joke out of Romnut Billery Sanatorium. You know, that the names that are coming, and Obama. I mean, this, where I got what happened with him, and I don't know why I'm not in the White House, but I have worked the Hill for so many years in D.C. and had my institute there for so long. How he could have, the second day in office, allowed for the bombing of Pakistan, who he, on one side of his mouth, calls his friend, and killed, I think it was 26 or 20-something innocent people. The very second day he was in office, and I went, oh, my God. this is not who we thought it was.
They bribed him with dollar signs and power.
Mm-hmm. That's supposed to be happening around the world, doesn't it? So I'm really, really researching, and I hope people out there will help me and give ideas, with who are the leaders of the different countries, the man-made boundaries that we can approach and say, look, it's in everybody's best interest to sign this, to sign and get it ratified by your parliament or Congress, whatever you have, in 2012, before it's too late, before the momentum of funding and vested interests take over. And that's what's happened through all the peace actions that have taken place, where we've stood out in the street and protested. What has that done? The biggest war game in recorded history is taking place now, and it's mandating to weaponize space. And the distractions out there are quite intentional. And even a couple of peace groups, I know, one of them that, because I worked with von Braun, spread this rumor that I'm a Nazi. You know, give me a break. And or that some congressman that I booked didn't show up at an event because he didn't want to go, he told me, and they thought I didn't do it. They look for excuses to try to discredit you, stupid, childish little games. And then we have a chance now to get this treaty signed that actually establishes a real, real, real framework that assures that the space above all our heads will remain to be a neutral frontier. That is not the intention of the vision for 2020 that every other page says domination and control. And because I worked in the industry, I know it's far worse than that. There are a lot of people out there that actually believe that Armageddon should happen or rapture will, and so it's okay to just tear down the rainforest. So what? And yeah, it trickles down to the economy, and it's always about money, money, money in the human state. But here we have a way with this to, as I said, acknowledge the indigenous nations, the indigenous cultures, and the cosmic cultures. And they are acknowledged as being, by the way, parties to the treaty. Of course, we know they can't sign an official UN treaty. And the UN member nation countries can. And I'm told that once we get one or two of these leaders to sign and ratify it, that probably at least 50% of the countries will sign on to it immediately. I don't think any leader really wants weapons over their heads or over the heads of the people. And what's happening is, though, you see our president going around tempting or threatening with the so-called missile defense system that actually at this stage of it is based on basing weapons in space. And that's doable. In spite of the rumors, there are no weapons in space. And even if there were, this would ban them verifiably because we all know it, people know what's in space. They have to register. There are no secrets. The countries are working together. And this is the time to get that done. And this treaty then will put a lid on the whole war industry and that mindset and allow it then to be transformed. And that's the kind of frequency you were talking about earlier, Catherine. It's just a notch. It's like turning a channel into another frequency, and it's exciting. And the aerospace defense industries, it's all in the controllers, if I can use that word, it's in their best interest too. They will see the advantage of just banning the space-based weapons part that will inevitably trickle down to us being able to get rid of the nukes and other dangerous and polluting technologies. And there are many of us working on alternative technologies. I'm actually working with a consortium of energy, alternative energy people, and presenting those projects to a couple of presidents of countries, not just going in with a treaty directly, because we found that that's what those countries needed. These country leaders are offered, this is really important to know, extended business and trade, a seat in NATO, financial assistance, food distribution, anything that they need, just come work on missile defense with me. And there's nothing defensive about it. It's just another lie.
Absolutely.
And this treaty will change the whole game. I really hope people will go to peaceandspace.com and just read it, because there's nothing like it, and look who wrote it, that ever existed. I've never seen a document like this, and we're, again, not trying to build a movement around it. It might just be a good story for some people to take a look at and read, because it is a milestone of our time, of our generation, of whoever is lucky enough to actually get a chance to read it. And then look at the unlimited, read between the lines, maybe it even says it in the treaty, it does to some degree, the unlimited benefits and the opportunities to all of us, to all of humankind around the world by this being signed in every area of concern. that we're all working on, and we can't stop working on all the issues. But in every area, health, education, stimulating the economy with a whole new marketplace of products and services, and security based on cooperation instead of confrontation, new energy, and the people I'm working with are leaving openings for free energy because we're going to get to the zero point. A lot of people have different technologies, but nobody's had the money to actually, that we know of, create it, although there are some countries that supposedly have it. It's still being controlled and kept quiet. And the environmental needs that we will be able to start solving the problems of are just unlimited. And that is going to do us in, too, if we don't get a grip on how to live in harmony with nature, what the indigenous people did originally, and how we can see the future that we can see through the cosmos cultures, the many. And I've met so many witnesses now, such an interesting thing, that disclosure project. I would never have met those people if it hadn't been for Dr. Stephen Greer, who also says none of them are hostile. I mean, there are people that will just deny that up the hill and tell you about their fear-based experiences, but that would might have been in the past because some experimenting was done, but it isn't happening and hasn't for a couple of years now. So we just together, those of us who will get this when they read it, and I'm sorry to talk so fast. I have so much I'd like to get in. And
no, you're doing great.
It's hard to do it in a couple of
minutes. You're making my job very easy. I love it.
Stop, interrupt me. Do not hesitate.
No, go.
Because I'm really excited about this. I really was ready to quit after what happened to us when we left the country and to my husband and me. And now that these courageous, incredible men and many women too, like P in Denmark and Dr. Rami Kildee, who knows about psychotronic weapons, who's in there, and Renata Longato in Peru. There are a lot of people, and Rashid Guardia in Bolivia. We just have some people in all kind of different countries that are working on different aspects of getting this treaty signed in their countries, and a couple of others that don't want to be mentioned yet. But I'll tell you about my experience with President Putin, who's being protested over there later. That's another one. Because I think he might know who I am. I hope so, because I'm about to make an appointment with him, and I'm buying him a chess set in case anybody's in Russia. He plays chess, and he likes people who are ahead of him, 12 steps ahead. He's a very interesting character. And so I think there are people out there in different countries. There are presidents around the world and prime ministers, kings, queens, like I mentioned, who will be excited about this treaty. And together, you and I mean, you know, I always feel like I'm a sixth grade school teacher, child psychologist, applying it. And, I mean, I've been a bartender and a waitress and a ski instructor, and I have this other huge bio that looks like I slipped through the aerospace cracks in the industry and the revolving door somehow and met these amazing people. But I've never seen anything like this.
And all of those jobs brought you to where you are now, Carol. That's the beautiful part about it all. None of it was a mistake.
Wow. Well, it sure is an interesting thing now. And I haven't gotten one negative note in the last 3 and some months that I've been back in the States, which is also very unusual for me, because when somebody comes out of the industry, you really don't know who to trust. I mean, I really do understand people that don't. I don't trust a lot of people right now. I used to be all inclusive, but now I discern more. And because I see that there are a lot of betrayers out there and a lot of massive egos and agents and people with self or corporate interests, you know, and they're not going to help. And so I just soon not even be in touch with them, really. But the people that come from heart and love and can really hear and intuit and just, you know, I wanted to be a trucker. My mother trucker is my handle, by the way, on my CB radio. So, you know, somehow I didn't get to be a trucker. I thought that would be really fun driving across the country. I still do. So there's a lot we can do together, and that's my whole thing right now. And I think this treaty is going to bring the people together who get a chance or lucky enough to go to that peaceandspace.com website or to get down to Texas in May. If you're listening to this before that May 17th conference, go to starworksusa.com and come on down there, because that is going to be fun and we'll have time to really hang out.
Well, I love that it not only bans all space-based weapons of any type, any kind, it also, like you said, includes the indigenous and cosmic keyword cultures. And it also acknowledges that we are not alone in this universe, or the universes, as you like to say, and that we are cosmic. We do have cosmic cultures, and the policy must reflect that in our reality for it to actually.
That's so well put. And, you know, you really hit on a lot of really good points in what you just said, that we are not alone. And to not teach that in the schools or to make it only science fiction is sinful. But okay. When you talk to people who come from a very strong belief system of almost any kind, whether it's strong religious, you know, the good parts about religion all have the same themes of peace and love and light and all of that. And Timothy Leary said it all when he died. And, you know, he's the Harvard professor that really got a bad rap because he was telling people to expand their consciousness and unfortunately did it through LSD and a lot of drugs. And it turned out I don't even take aspirin and I don't drink alcohol. Maybe I'll have a sip of wine and that's enough to get me drunk. So I'm very careful. I'm a cheap drunk. I don't know a more sophisticated way to say that. So I'm kind of against it, but I have experimented with expanding my consciousness because I'm an educator. And to be an educator, I want to know what the brain and mind is conscious is possible to apply to our life, to building a sustainable, healthy, happy, clean garden planet and lifestyle. And that's why I loved Edgar Mitchell, because here's a guy who had an out-of-body and experience in space and looked back and went, oh my God, you know, what is this? And came back as a military Republican, you know, and said, here's what happened to me. And of course, rather than be institutionalized, he founded his own institute to study the brain and the mind and consciousness. And I asked him before I did an interview, before I left for that country, which I've been back almost 3.5 years, no, 3 years and a few months. And then I was in that other country for 4 years. And I said, you know, I'm going to do one interview before I leave, but I think something's wrong with me. Either I'm not articulating this well enough, because all we have to do is get a ban on space-based weapons. Game over, new game. It's simple. As an educator, little boys fighting, give them another toy. You know, give them something else to do, and they will not fight. They will play. I'm doing it with my two puppies right here. I mean, it's just an instinct that we all have, looking for something better, more fun, better, loving, you know, exciting. And what's more than space that fits that description?
Absolutely.
So I asked him what it is that I'm doing wrong. I mean, I am really, in my mind, a school teacher. I am an educator. I love working with children. And he said, well, Carol, there's something, it isn't you. And I said, it is me. I can't seem to get this conversation across. I mean, if it's true that I started a movement that ended up with about 50 million people, or helped start it, because a lot of people worked on this, to stop Star Wars. The Leaky Umbrella campaign, the campaign to save outer space, debating General Daniel Graham, who briefed Reagan, who announced the SDI, and I named it the Star Wars program, thanks to a reporter, Kevin Sanders, who said, you can't keep saying Strategic Defense Initiative. Nobody can say that. Call it Star Wars. And I remember saying, he was on CNN, the science syndicated editor or journalist. And I said, I can't call it Star Wars. That's a movie. And he said, if you do, I'll help you start a movement. And at the time, I barely knew what a movement was. Well, if we didn't get it done then, this is back now in the, you know, 70s, 80s, then if we continue doing the same approach, we're not going to get any change to happen. So we have to change our approaches now, too. And I'm jumping ahead now for a minute, but that's why I think it's so important to focus on a world direction. This Congress is just, and this administration in this country, I don't think we should give up on them. We do have to educate and see who is educable. Some people are not educable. I hate to admit, I always thought, maybe it was my ego, but I always thought I can reach people. And Edgar said, no, it's not you. It's that the human species is a stupid species. Well, I said, Edgar, I cannot go on the air and say, it's hard enough being a curly-haired woman in a short skirt. I mean, no way. And I can't say that. And he said, well, you can quote me. And I said, but as an educator, that's, you know, and confrontational. I mean, it's all wrong to say that. No, he said, it is a stupid species. Now, we have been dumbed down by intention or by belief systems, and we just haven't evolved yet. So it's not like a big blame statement. It's just an observation. But in fact, what you're seeing and what I'm seeing is that there are plenty of intelligent people out there. But the dinner conversation is not about outer space, especially about banning space-based weapons. It might be about a hotel that's being built in space, which is being built. It might be about craft or some space junk that just made some astronauts, cosmonauts have to leave their craft and go hide from a piece of coming in space junk. You know, it might be scary things like the asteroids are coming or the, you know, ETs are coming, all these things. It's just not that we don't need to deal with the asteroid situation, but just can't go shoot one. If it splinters, one of those splinters could be worse than the asteroid. There are ways of handling all this. And the ETs, the extraterrestrial, the cosmos cultures, I can hardly say the word ET. It's been so discredited, except for I love the movie. We call them cosmos cultures in this treaty. And if you allow them to come in, which we're going to, and by the way, anybody that works on this will be on the front lines. And I just talked with Scott Jones. I want to jump into this too, because yes, people are stupid. It's just because we're not aware of this. And so get a hold of that treaty and teach your kids and read it in different languages, because it's really an important document that kind of summarizes where we are today. It's a milestone, really, document. We have a chance now to educate people, but we also have a chance to create another whole new reality. And that's really what we're talking about doing. So, yeah, we're stupid. Pretty much all of us are, I think, because we've been carefully taught and dumbed down, all of us. None of us can get out of that. But you travel to a place where they don't even have education, where they're sitting on the street living in their mud hut if they're lucky enough to have one. And I've been there. And the little boy comes over and hands you a bottle cap that you can make into a ring. Not a cap, one of the little cans that when you open a can, the pop top. This happened to me, actually. And I put this little ring on, and that's all he had, and that was his gift for me. You start to get that we are what the we are all one means. And we are, but we are so divided on this planet. When you get these leaders that get, candidates rather, that get on the TV and say things like, the Russians are our enemy, the Chinese are our foes, and they better all fear us. What?
Yeah.
And that's what these candidates are saying.
They better feel fear consciousness is what they better fear.
And I'm not going to vote for some candidate ever, Republican registered as I was. I am not going to vote for a candidate that ties his dog to a car roof and goes on a trip. Sorry.
If that's ridiculous.
Not an example of where that consciousness is, not to make stress.
Jeez.
So I think we have to, if we only have two candidates, oh, well, I guess we, you know, I can't tell people what to do, but I do know there's no way I'm going to vote for the candidate that ties his dog to the roof of a car.
I don't blame you there.
And can't relate to me, who is part of the 99. You know, it just isn't going to happen. And I think what we have to do in any case is those of us who are getting the kind of show that you do, where you bring in very intelligent people who have concluded something and are producing some form of action in some area of concern. This is only one, and I certainly don't expect everybody to jump in and want to get involved in banning weapons from space. Although, to me, an educator, and I think no matter what issue you come to, where is the money going instead of going into feeding people and healing people, cleaning up the environment, it's going into some aspect of the war game. And this changes that game. It gives them, as I was saying, something else to do. And that's what this is. It's the only game in town that's big enough, grand enough, to replace the war game, the space game. In other words, we can't have peace on Earth if we don't have it in space. It's just not going to happen unless it's from, you know, all of us, our bodies just being obliterated, and then we get into another dimension and we sure find peace there. But I'm kind of happy experimenting with the one that I'm in this body. You know, we know that there are other dimensions because we can experiment with them and find out and meditate. And you certainly don't, I want to be clear, need to do drugs to get there. It just was a tool for a lot of us in the 60s, at least, and some people now too. I gave it one speech last year at a university, and they actually didn't want to hear about any of the things I talk about. They wanted to know about Timothy Leary and the drugs and Terrence McKenna and the mushrooms and that whole psychedelic club. And the reason they wanted to know is because they were so far advanced from their teachers, they're all straight A students, even their parents came to my presentation because they heard this. I knew some of those people. And what I got was that they're so high, a lot of the children now, because they've been working on technology from such an early age, that their brains are, as Timothy would say, their brains compute differently than ours do. So even though some of them went through that structure and wanted to know about it, they're all getting now that they don't need the drugs at all. They just need to meditate, go out in nature, get in a quiet place, and they will be given information about other dimensions and universes. But if they start listening to the people writing the books and giving speeches, if they have a gut feeling maybe they shouldn't be listening, or that it's a passed down footnote that may be a little bit spun, selling a good book, or, you know, presenting some fear factor, because fear sells so much more than does a peace story, then they get twisted. But if they can rise above it and get into a natural, quiet state, they can get to the same places without the drugs, because the frequency is changing now. I mean, 2012 is supposed to be disastrous, and, you know, but actually it's an opportunity for change, and I don't think we can go by any certain date. And what I think the bottom line to all of that is that we have a way now of experiencing a whole new reality. And that shift of consciousness is taking place. It's actually happening. And some people are aware of it and some aren't. But what's happening at the same time, we can't sit around in la-la land and say, oh, everything's going to be wonderful because the ETs are going to come and intervene and there's some galactic club out there that's going to be in charge of us. It's just not true. The only way, bottom line, that we're going to find out the real truth about who we really are in these bodies, in these man-made natural boundaries on this planet, in the universe and in the universes, is in fact to meet our cosmos neighbors. And the rest of it is up for grabs, except for the few people you know, and you will, if you tune in, be able to tell who's telling the truth, the real truth, and then seeing where it falls out without the doubt and without the human perspective in it, which is always divisive. I catch myself in it all the time. It's just how we were programmed. Maybe some of them are evil aliens. Maybe the Chinese are coming to get us. Well, I'm an official advisor to China, and that's the last thing they want to do. And, you know, the doubt thing, if not the fear thing, is something we're all carefully taught. It's a belief, part of the belief systems that have kept us dumb.
Absolutely.
So we have these chances now of, we're not just seeking a new direction, some of us are taking it. And those who want to join into the exciting part of that, I think I'm having the most exciting, incredible time I've ever had. And there are moments when I go really down and say, oh, I give up, that's it, throwing in the towel. And then somebody will write me a really nice note, you know, or something that taps me back up and wakes me back up like a cup of coffee would, you know. I get energized again. And it's because the high, the natural high of the human state is what we've been squashing.
I'm on one right now talking to you, Carol.
Oh, I am talking with you too, thanks. And I hope it's contagious, our energy.
It most certainly
is. It's who we are. And if we can just keep the space around us, and it's over all our heads, free of weapons, and not buy into, there are already weapons up there, so forget it, go home. I mean, I've been in debates where they've told me HAARP is a space-based weapon. HAARP, first of all, HAARP hasn't even been active for a couple of years. They ran out of money, so they couldn't run it, and it didn't cause the Japanese earthquake. But you'll hear all this stuff go out there anyway. Or the ETs are, they've been fighting in space. Have you seen an ET fighting in space?
No, I really haven't.
Yeah, I mean, I want to say to people,
they're flying around a lot, but I don't see any fire being returned.
Yeah, really. I saw my first craft. It wasn't a weather balloon. And, you know, I was one of the skeptics for so long. I mean, I didn't get hired in the aerospace defense industry because I was a peace activist. You know, I was brought up like the rest of the Republicans, you know, and people.
Isn't that ironic?
Yeah, and Democrats too. Some of us, you know, all of us now have been fed this information or the doubt. And I just can't speak at these conferences where there are the doubters or the people talking about their fear-based experiences, because either they don't exist or they were in the past or they interpreted it, or it does exist and they need to move into another reality so that they don't experience it anymore. And all of that is possible because we can all create our own realities. And there's no guarantee. Oh, in my visit, oh my God, in my visit with this extraterrestrial group, the one where there was another man in the room with me, and it's happened for an hour and a half. It wasn't like a little quick visit. They, one of the most profound things they said to me was, there were two. They kept repeating, none of us are hostile. Everything's in control in the universes now. They have evolved too. There is such a thing as they learn and they get everything. I mean, now you can go get a divorce and you can fight and beat up each other and, you know, whatever. Or you can have a happy divorce and actually celebrate it and still love each other and just go your separate ways. And so we can evolve into a different state, although some people don't believe that. That's true. And the other thing they said, the first one, none of them are hostile. Everything's in control in the universes. Now it's time for us humans to wake up enough to at least do what's possible, the banning of space-based weapons, so that they can be invited in for those of us who want an official visit. And we will be on the front lines because we will invite them in. And I wanted to mention that first one to you, and I'm going to tell you what Scott Jones said to me just a few minutes before the show started. The other profound thought was that there are no guarantees due to the human ego. In other words, I can work my you-know-what off day and night as I have been doing for almost 40 years on this issue. And I am really tired of it, Catherine. I'm so tired of doing this. But we all want a pleasant, wonderful life. And not too many of us, except if we're doing it in our mind and spirit and in a loving state, we're still seeing what's going on the planet. But the other profound thought, there are no guarantees due to the human ego. Oh, geez. I just hope there are enough of your listeners and enough of us out there to say, okay, I'm going to go read that treaty and see if there's something that I can do to help. If you can just send me a check, there's a PayPal there so that I can buy the tickets, because that's the stage at which I am. I wasn't planning on saying that on your show, but I just realized I'm going to update the website really fast, and I'm waiting now just for phone calls from two countries worth of people that if I can get these appointments, I'm going, no matter.
Any little bit will add up to what Carol needs to do to get the job done, because she has paid a high price financially herself.
Really, you know, I'm a volunteer, and we lost everything doing this, and it's okay. We're fine. People sent me boxes of care packages. I have so many clothes and shoes now. I'm like a shoeaholic. If anybody wears a size 8.5, you got mine. So it's like, you know, people are so generous. I'm giving stuff back to Goodwill now because they even donated stuff to us when we got back. And it's just been an amazing experience, but there are no guarantees. We could all end up in a really bad place unless we're self-sufficient. Hopefully people are working on their learning their emergency skills and all of that. I wanted to share with you one more thing, and I'm going to stop and see if you have any questions. I have been chattering so much. I just talked with Dr. Scott Jones before, and again, his bio is on the website, peaceandspace.com. And he said that I could share this with you, and this is the first time I've ever said this, ever, in public. I have been hinting this, but he said that I could even mention his name too, because as we talked today, we found out that we've both been given the same message. And the message is that you want to be on the front line when the cosmos cultures land on one of these landings, participate in getting this treaty signed into law. We're going to be given that gift. Now, If I said that by myself, I might sound like I've got a screw loose, that I'm a slight lunatic, which sometimes I think I am. No, but I would. It sounds so bizarre, like I would have made it up. But when you look at that man's credentials, and he's been told the same thing, and we're not crazy people, you will see that there's something to what we've been told. So I want to really encourage people to help. Do what you can. At least tune in, if that's all you can do, to what this is all about, so that you start functioning in a higher frequency and we don't get dragged into any of those old belief systems or control mechanisms. I am, by the way, as of tomorrow, I finally procrastinated enough to tomorrow to giving up all the sugar that I eat because I am being controlled by that. Not that it's all bad. I was working with 400 old people, many of whom were over 100 in the place that I lived before. Now they're all dying because the Americans and that other frequency moved in and did the land grab and changed the energy there. But they were eating raw sugarcane, organic sugarcane every day, and coffee with caffeine every day, and meat, chicken and pig mostly, but some beef, and white rice. And that's the opposite of what I know to eat here. And each of our bodies and our minds and we're different, we're on different places on the path. And I've tried to be a vegetarian and, you know, we're going through different phases of our own evolutions. But if you can make any personal health corrections, do that too. The cosmos cultures are not eating each other and they couldn't and be transparent and walk through a wall and get into that frequency. And I don't know much more about that. Other people know a lot more about it than I do. I've just had the experiences that I can share with you. And then I've gone around and talked with other high-level credentialed people because I thought if they've gotten themselves into some position, maybe they know something. Of course, then I found out when I worked in the Congress, it wasn't necessarily true. How they got in wasn't because of their super intelligence. Anyway, there's some of them. Maybe a lot of them, actually. Anyway, but what I really did get was that we need to start making some personal corrections and get above into ride the wave of moving into a different state so that we can, as Timothy Leary would say, ride the light into space with our friends, because that is what we're going to do inevitably. So one of the things that just was so astonishing to me just today before your show was this conversation with Dr. Jones, because for him to say to me what I have already written, I know that he never heard me say it because I've never said it before myself to anyone, is that the people who do work on this will be invited to be on the front lines. And there are many people that know that they are, quote, ambassadors, or they have different names for whatever it is that they can identify themselves as being. And I'll bet you many people on the show feel that somehow they feel different from humanity, or that they're different. Maybe they don't fit in to their family or the community or even their relationship or relationships. There's something that maybe you feel different or disconnected in a way, like you're observing instead of part of it. And that's part of because of who we are, all of us as cosmos people. We're all those same of that same frequency. And then there are different levels and dimensions of it, obviously, because as we all become aware of something new, and especially about this issue that the space issue brings us into, we start to see that there is more to the life that we've been living, and then it depends on how far you allow yourself to travel, how far you allow your being to be open, really open and free. That's what freedom is about, and we're real far away from freedom all over the planet right now. We've allowed ourselves to be controlled, and it's time. We're at the time. 2012 to me is like a symbol of the time. It's based on Mayan and Hopi and all the different wisdom, words of wisdom and predictions and all of that. And we're human in these bodies and we're spirits in these bodies. And we have a chance to do something great, 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 and change it. Not just for ourselves, and tritely, cornily, I say, for the children and the future and all of that, but wow, we're alive right now, and this is 2012, and we're right here, and a lot of witnesses have gone public about this disclosure. It's taken place. It doesn't need to take place anymore. Those people who know that this is a reality know it. It's a matter of how they perceive it, maybe, but a lot of people, growing numbers of people know it. And the few of us who get tapped into this treaty, the few of us who get exposed to this, I consider us to be about as lucky as you can possibly be on this planet, because, like I said, the only game that can replace the old one is the one that recognizes who we are in the universes. And that, when you read the treaty, that's the story that it tells.
Absolutely. I think we all chose to incarnate at this very moment for this very reason, you know, for expanding consciousness. The planets are aligning. Things are shifting. Let's just bring on the golden age. Enough with the dumb stuff.
What attracted you to this treaty?
You, Carol, honestly, I mean, I have a affinity in my heart for you because you're a Delaware girl like me.
Yes, we're women to Delaware. Isn't that
yeah.
a
Facebook? So I feel a connection there. Yes, we met on Facebook over a year ago and started conversing, and here we are today. So I don't want the fear. I don't want the weapons. A lot attracts me to it, honestly. You know, I can go on and on. But I'm very proud of you. You are, I'm going to dub you the cosmic warrior right now. Because that's what
oh,
you are.
Thank you. Well, I'll take that. Because I do feel like a warrior sometimes.
You are.
That maybe that'll help give me the strength when I'm falling apart and things.
Most big wigs don't have the chops to contend with the likes of you. Know that.
Well, you know, I think, yeah, thank you. I think what's funny about this whole thing is that we all have it. When I started getting this music coming into me out of nowhere land, it was so inspiring to me because I thought a musician is writing this stuff about the treaty. Wait till you hear the words of these songs. It's amazing. And then I look at the part of the treaty that's written about the parties to the treaty, the part that acknowledges the indigenous cultures and the cosmos cultures. I mean, is that not a riot? A cosmos culture. The indigenous, maybe not. That's pretty serious. But when you think about it, we're talking in a treaty about off-planet cultures. Yes, we are. And here we are in this treaty. We're actually reaffirming something that we know, that's the urgency of presenting a very destabilizing, threatening, and costly race in space to weaponize it and kill ourselves. Now, if some people want to put on a uniform and go kill themselves in a war because it is a suicide mission, whether they come back in a body bag or as a person or
it's
as
so
a person,
sad.
Yeah, without arms or legs or, you know, somehow injured or with post-traumatic stress syndrome or suicidal. If they want to go do that, great, go do it. But stop killing the people and making them suffer and causing 500 million orphans on this planet. How dare those people do that under the guise of I'm a hero, my father wants me to do it, my mother was, no way. It's a terrible thing to do.
Most of those people are young kids who just want a job and a chance to go to college.
Absolutely.
They're lied to on the premise of being a hero and going to school, and that, you know, that's the American dream. And the other half are just so grandfathered in that they don't want to give up their pensions.
That's,
you know?
Right. And you know what I got to? Oh, this is so important you brought that up, because we've redefined the militarization in space. Listen, the militarization of Earth is always about weapons. All destruction, suffering, weapons, domination, control, who's got seizing the high ground, which in yours and my generation and everyone listening, the high ground is in space. That's the game. Seize the high ground, because you can always see everything as high up as you can get. So that's the game. Now, in space, however, you can't get into space without military involvement. Even the entrepreneurs that are doing things, we had to launch Timothy Leary's ashes through the Celestis Company in Texas, by the way, from Vandenberg Air Force Base.
I love that.
Yeah, it was really amazing. And so what we've done is we've redefined militarization. And I've actually briefed the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines at the Space Command, the top management, right? So I go in and I say, I'm really not qualified to accept this. Of course, they need a woman. That's how I got into half of this stuff. And I say, I'm not qualified to do it, but if you'll let me meet the top brass of the Army, Navy, Air Force. So I go around, I interview them. Now I go to do the briefing. And I think there were 29 of them there. That number may not be exactly accurate. But I remember I got from each person why these space-based weapons are a dumb, dangerous, destabilizing, too costly, unnecessary, untestable idea. But I started giving that as my talk to them. They wanted to hear my viewpoint because they need a woman and they needed another viewpoint, I guess. So there I was presenting it to the top brass of the military and the Space Command in Colorado Springs.
I love being underestimated, Carol. I love it.
Well, what I did that really was even funny and amazing to me was I took a point from what each one of them said when I gave all the reasons for why this was a really bad idea to weaponize space, and I could see them because there I was a woman, and they were kind of punching each other with their elbows and smirking, and finally, I said, look, I see all of you guys smirking. I get it. But I just want you to know that not one of these points on this blackboard here didn't come from one of you. Every point on this board came from one of you in this room. Well, you could have heard a pin drop.
Absolutely.
Nobody said another word. And so I got that we're all smart. We just have to come up with something new. And the new, the only thing new that's happening on this planet that I can see is our evolution into space. And most people don't know that they're building space hospitals, schools, labs, farms, industries, space habitats, craft. And they certainly don't know what the unlimited benefits and opportunities are that come from this technology. Who's having that dinner time conversation? Not too many people. And only a few hundred people have actually stepped off the planet, you know. And so there are young people, but the space program in the United States has been so cut back. It's just absolutely absurd because that's where the jobs are that are going to be stimulated in the space age. I mean, look what's happening now that we keep chopping everything, all the good budgets out. When I was teaching school, they were chopping out phys ed and music. I mean, we were rebelling against that. Now they're chopping out even the best of the information that's available to all of us with this high technology that can solve the urgent problems of human needs, of new energy, of the environment that we're all going to be experiencing if we don't apply space age solutions. So you have a lot of people looking for funding and trying to get things done to solve different issues. I volunteer once in a while here with the homeless, and I tried to volunteer in the animal shelter, but I got fired because you're not allowed to cry when people don't adopt the animals. That's really a terrible experience. But anyway,
love you, Carol. We really love you. I just have to say that.
Okay. A cat adopted me. I have Kitty Kitty here, a little calico cat with my two poodles that got donated. And I also got training, by the way, for the emergencies. I want to reemphasize that little point because if we don't get this treaty signed, we better be trained in CPR, in, you know, reviving hearts, in all the great nutritional ways that we can enhance our lives.
And there's also some technology that's being suppressed that could help with that issue as well.
Exactly. We have so much to learn. I mean, you could do whole shows on how to solve these problems, starting with yourself and your family. I have something interesting. I signed up and I quit now, but I got a lot of emergency training from CERTS, the Community Emergency Response Team. There are communities all over the U.S. called CERTS, but that have this program called CERTS, Community, C-E-R-T-S, Community Emergency Response Team. So I joined it, and then one day, guess what I found out? Who funds CERTS? Homeland Security and FEMA, the Department of Defense.
Always follow the money.
You got it. So I got what I could out of it, and then I went, oh my God, what are they really planning? I'm not quite sure. But in any case, you can get a lot of free training, take advantage of it, and learn your emergency techniques, learn how to farm, grow vegetables and food in your house, figure out where you can get clean water. It's hard to find clean air because radiation has so spread. I'm in Oregon, and we're just getting radiated. And I got radiation in Russia from one of the 29 Chernobyl-like accidents that most people don't know about that happened.
Wow.
And if it hadn't been for a German doctor, I wouldn't even be sitting here. My husband had to sit me in a bathtub, and I turned bright red with all the stuff I had to swallow. And for a couple of weeks, it was horrible. And the man that I lived with there, he and his wife, the doctor of cosmonauts, Vladimir Kurshvili, apparently he died of radiation poisoning. And it's a terrible way to go. Very, very.
It's showing up in soil samples here. Well.
Yes, it is. Yes, and you can't hide from it. I just talked with this wonderful woman, Rosalind Peters, who's an expert in chemtrails and radiation and all of that. And I've been trying to find out, where do you go? Where can you be safe? I thought it was where I was in another country south of the border. And she said, oh, that's ridiculous. They're just not getting the news, so they think they're all safe. You can't hide. What you have to do is what we're talking about, change the frequency, and we can do it with our thoughts, too. If we start getting out of the negatives, as soon as you see yourself catching a negative thought, and boy, I work on this. I'm not good at it. I have to admit, I get sucked in and I cry a lot watching the news. And my husband's a crier. He's an actor. I guess he taps into all these emotions, he tells me. But he cries at telephone ads, you know.
Well, you're both very empathic, and that says a lot about who you are.
Well, yeah, thanks. We all have that heart in us. and we have to now deal with ourselves first. And I learned this at CERTS. Yourself first, get as healthy as you possibly can. I just bought hip-hop tapes, hip-hop exercise tapes, because I hate to exercise. So I did the body transformation one time for Body for Life, but then I went back to Snickers, so that didn't work. But now I'm going to dance away and just get music into your life and get art into your life. These musicians really inspired me that wrote these songs. And then look at your family or who's around you and make sure that you're around non-toxic people. If they hurt your gut or make you cry or they hurt you or betray you, walk away. We can choose who we want to be around now. And so I've heard from people all over that we're creating our own family and then inevitably realizing that our real family is around the world. And not too many people get to travel like we did in the old days when we didn't worry about diseases or hunger or see so much suffering. But now it's very difficult. In fact, we're pretty much prisoners on this planet in so many different ways, from the fact that you're afraid to go to different places because you will get sick or you might get killed, to the fact that some of us may be on a list and not allowed to travel. Or something may happen to you that's pretty bad in another country because the laws are so different in that country. You know, some countries, it's the Napoleonic law, so you're considered to be guilty until proven innocent, the opposite of here. And you can be sued or charged with anything, and it can be a total lie, and you can be imprisoned until that your court case comes up in 5 years.
Sort of what the Patriot Act's trying to do to us right now.
Oh, I was just getting to that. And the people who know about that, and the laws that are being set up right now that can put us in prison for saying the wrong thing, I usually don't say things against the politicians anyway. But I think there's something a little bit rebellious in me right now. Maybe it's because you're from my hometown and I can come move in with you, right?
Absolutely, Carol.
You know, that I feel like the truth now has to be told in the strongest, most powerful way we can possibly do it as we become aware of it to whoever we can reach, or even if it's just internally, to let it vent through our bodies so that we don't get sick from it and so that we do start to turn that into the most positive vision and the most positive action that each of us can take. In my case, it's the treaty, because I see that that will change the whole game. You know, we really can have peace on Earth and in space by changing the whole game of war into a space industry without weapons in space. We can knock on the government's doors. In fact, that's the other song that Pia Larsson in Denmark wrote. I think it's called Knocking on Government's Doors. And again, I'll send anybody these songs. They're just so great. And she's written another one that just came out. I haven't even listened to this final version, called Deactivation. There are ways that we can feed ourselves with good information, good music, like the one you played at first, the last card. And that last card is from that statement that, to me, this is the last that any of us have to deal with suffering or people around us that are toxic or government officials that are so ignorant, so stupid, so selfish, so greedy, and so playing that old game that they're about to obliterate all of us and cause all this suffering in us first with these, you know, genetically modified foods. I mean, how dare them do this to us? I'm sorry. This is
no.
You know, you can get into the vaccinations and look how many autistic children, from any one of a number of different means, that children are becoming autistic. That's another whole story. Or cancers. I had cancer. I had a cervical cancer. I had to go down to Mexico to get ozone treatments, the type of cancer I had didn't survive in ozone. And the doctor, who unfortunately died now, Dr. William Hitt, he was treating people with AIDS and cancers and multiple sclerosis. And the types, there are different types of cures, of healthy, natural cures, not radiation that kills you anyway, for cancer and for these horrible diseases. And if I could get over radiation poisoning, there is something that can be done. We can make this huge correction. And my husband says I should say believe, because it may turn people off if I say I know. I'm sorry. I know that if we can get to ban space-based weapons, as far as that thought out, it is out there, as far as that thought is out there, and recognize that we are all children of the universe. I used to play that John Denver song, one of my old loves. I love him. And I'm sorry he's gone because he wrote such amazing music. And I played his song, Children of the Universe. You can listen to it on YouTube after speeches that I used to give. And if we can get this ban on space-based weapons, recognize that we are not alone in the universe, who we really are, that we've been out of balance, that it's been a very male, macho-dominated world. That's the reason, one of the reasons, aside from Paula Harris, who's so great, who wrote a number of books interviewing people who have had ET or UFO kinds of experiences, many, many experiences. She even just has a new one out with one of my favorite witnesses, Clifford Stone. Look him up and get his book, because he was a military guy who worked with ETs on a military base. Not lying.
And we'd love to have him on. If you could put in a good word for us, that'd be great.
I'll connect you to him. He's absolutely wonderful. And imagine a military man that's gone public and one of his kids was killed. We've all been threatened, and we're not wah-wah-wahing about it, although once in a while you hear somebody is that's selling their books or tapes or something. He's very humble. He's Christian. You know, I don't get into the religious parts myself, but he comes from that place, and he actually worked with ETs on a military base and went public. And it's cost him a lot, too. This man has really suffered. And his book, Paula Harris, just put it together. She's just amazing. That's aside from putting women together to speak at this May conference in Texas that I really hope people will come to, and so we can meet and compare notes. His book is amazing. And so he also gets that none of them are hostile. Duh. We've held them prisoner and we've reverse engineered craft, and we can find out now how to have a fossil free planet. The consortium that I'm working with are building alternative solar and other technologies, but they're leaving openings for the free zero point energy, which we will have if we survive. And if we can connect to this space issue, this space age that we're in, the few people who do, it's going to be amazing what's going to happen. And we can do it. It's not, some people will say, oh, yeah, 15, 20 years. Well, I've been hearing that for 40 years, and I'm sorry. I've had it. I don't want to wait for more time. Like I said, I want to retire and enjoy my life, and I'm enjoying it. I mean, I'm meeting you, and that's been great fun, but I'm, you know, meeting wonderful people, and this Facebook thing has just been amazing. That's the only networking thing that I got into because someone else signed me up on it, or I never would have done it. By the way, the Facebook thing is Carol Sue Rosin. Carol Rosin, someone else put up, and it filled up overnight practically. I don't know where this – I think it happened from years ago when I first came out with this in the early 80s. With the ban on space, the SOS campaign or the leaky. We were walking around with leaky umbrellas with holes in them because we said if missiles slipped through, one missile could just destroy all of us. 12 could destroy the whole planet. And Reagan was going for 150 of them. I mean, it was, and the peace groups were compromising in order to look politically effective and credible. They were saying, oh, we only need 1.4 million in the, and I was saying, wait a minute, you don't have any in this program. They've been working on it since the 40s or 50s, but we don't call for a compromise. Oh, we have to look politically effective and credible. Uh-uh. No compromise.
The time is now, Carol. The time is now. You won't have to work that hard much longer, I hope.
Well, I hope not too, and I hope people will help us get to these world leaders, because if we can, I'm willing to do it. I'm willing to get on the plane and go, and so are some other people with me. And if anybody else wants to do anything like that, just let me know. But we now have a treaty that's verifiable because we know it's in space. It's enforceable by the new enforcement mechanism, not by weapons enforcement, but by collaboration and cooperation. That's what enforcement means now. The militarization of space now means these kids and these guys can go into space and explore and learn and take these courses and learn skills from the military as we move into the space age that will be about cleaning up the planet, distributing food and water to where people have migrated, distributing medical care. That's what the militaries want. Most of the people I've met in the military are really good people. They want to be in service. And like you said, they want to learn a skill. They need a job. And that's the start of the new game of the military. The corporations, have a new job that they can do. They will create a whole new marketplace of space-age products and services. I founded years ago the World Entrepreneur Association to study scams and opportunities because I was always trying to figure out how to raise money to do what I was doing because nobody would hire me back in the industry if I was talking about changing the game. But now the time is right, like you just said, to change the game. So we're going to have a whole new security system that's based on cooperation, collaboration, including in the militaries that have been working together around the world anyway. And Obama's actually kind of started that off. He just did it on the wrong foot. It's not about cooperating on missile defense, Mr. Obama. It is about cooperating on going into the universes and backing up, solving the problems on the planet, and using our good military people to do good things. And they know what that means. They don't want to go off. Most of them, there are a few who like blood and guts for sure, but and they love playing those little war games for sure. But most of the people that I've met, and I've met a lot in the military, just want to be in service. And like you said, they want to learn the skills and have a job, and they want to do good things and come back alive and not broken up into pieces and having their best friends killed. And they don't want to be committing suicide, which so many of them are from the stress and the post-traumatic stress that they suffer with for so many years afterwards. And so we're going to have new jobs and profits from this new marketplace, and we're going to be able to apply the new technologies from the information that we get to the hardcore technologies that the kids are inventing in science classes, that can help solve the urgent problems of humans and the rest of our biosphere. There are a lot of things that need attention right now, and healing especially. Tamsin Williams and Hillary Ramo, who first started me out and was a radio show host that interviewed me, and she's on the website too. These are healers too. These are women healers that connected with me about this. It's kind of interesting because we all know we have to heal each other. And this treaty is going to further the purposes and principles of not only the new world order that we want and the world government that is the Gary Davis produced, but it actually supports the purposes and the principles of the charter, the original charter of the United Nations and the Declaration of Human Rights, which I got a chance to read and speak to at one of the Occupy meetings. And, you know, instead of then so many people have gathered and they're changing the world, waking people up around the world that they can empower themselves to do something through this Occupy movement. Imagine if some of them actually got involved too in doing all the things they're doing, the great things that they're doing, and also helping to really stand for all that. And if you haven't read it in a while, or you get somebody to talk about it on your show, the Declaration of Human Rights. I have it blown up in front of me every single day. And the Japanese say in their, they have Article 9. Most of the countries have articles in their own constitutions that actually talk about the Declaration of Human Rights. And you and I are not living in that life. Somebody has forgotten. They didn't teach it in the school. And they have forgotten that there is such a thing as the Declaration of Human Rights and that we have a right to live on this planet under the laws of the universal laws of nature and of cooperation and in peace. We have that right on this planet to support each other and not to be killing people overseas. These are laws written into the Declaration of Human Rights. I wish I had time to go over all those articles with you.
We need to have you back, Carol. We really do.
Yeah,
if you could find time in your schedule later in the year, that would be great. There's so much. I have a whole list of things to talk about, but you're flowing so nice. I don't want to stop you. You're just giving such great information.
Well, like I said, you have to interrupt me on this.
I don't want to.
Appreciate it. But, you know, this is about extending our lives into the universes. We have huge telescopes now that can see things deeper into the universes than we've ever seen before. People are outside having sky watches where many times they've seen craft. And like I said, many people have gone public with their ETs experiences. And some people like me have been very shy and, in fact, quiet about it for years because of the ridicule factor, not to mention the possible threats if you become a real whistleblower. And we just have to ignore all that and create another reality right now. And this treaty is open to all nation states for their signatures. And we intend to get this signed into law one way or the other. So please, everybody, you know, just send me your ideas, you know, send anything you can to help. And, you know, let's get it done. We can do this right now. And note that this treaty does not ban weapons on the Earth. This is, we will do that, of course, later, but first we have to do something that's really doable. And everything that it says in this treaty is doable.
We are unstoppable. Another world is possible.
For sure. And what we create is what's possible.
Absolutely.
So I just want to thank you for this opportunity of being able to spout and vent on your show.
No, I'm glad you did. We're honored to have you, Carol, really. It's been a very great day for our Truth Connections team and anyone who can listen to this either now or after in the archives. I have one question that I think people might want to know. Do you have any thoughts about what the crop circles, I know there's theories about what the crop circles are trying to tell us?
Well, once again, you know, it's pretty clear to me that there aren't a bunch of humans out there making some of these crop circles. That's pretty clear. I couldn't possibly guess, and I tend to not be one of the people who puts out a myth, theory, guess, opinion, perspective, or even interpretation of something that I don't know for a fact. But what I will say is it is possible to find out what they are, and that's by inviting the extraterrestrial beings in to tell us, did they do this, and what does it mean?
What percentage do you think is real and what percentage is fake, just a ballpark?
I really don't know. One of my contacts, the man in Bolivia, whose last name is Guardia, G-U-A-R-D-I-A, in Bolivia, Rashid, his name is, a dentist, I believe. He's a doctor. He has a collection unlike anyone I've ever seen on his Facebook page. And, of course, Suzanne Taylor and William Gazecki, there are some people who have put out great, and Suzanne's very aggressively promoting hers, her wonderful video. There are people out there that have, there are just so many. I couldn't list them, but you could probably find them on the Internet. And of the videos and photographs that are out there of crop circles, I find them to be absolutely fascinating. And one day before I even knew what a crop circle was, I was actually, I had cut a hole in the bathroom floor in the cement in that other country, and I was putting those little round pebbles that are different colors, and I drew one of those that looks like the one that's a kind of spiral. It goes a spiral that keeps branches go out and turn, and another one goes out and turns. And I didn't know that that was a crop circle at the time. I have a feeling that a lot of us are getting different images and symbols that are messages, but I don't want to dare to speculate. I wouldn't dare do it. I think they're probably
people
who have more information about it, but I wouldn't do it because
a lot of it has sacred geometry mixed in. That's why I was asking.
Oh, sure. Yeah, once again, there's so much interesting information that people have interpreted, and a lot of it sounds pretty intelligent to me, but I don't know for sure. I know for sure that I've had the experiences I have, so that's what I talk about. And I don't even surmise from my experiences. Basically, what I do is I can present to you what I know to be factual, what I've been given, and I know where it comes from. And I know the people that I work with and who they really are. I've been fooled by a few people. And especially in that other country, I was totally fooled, and a couple of people here. And so I'm much more discerning. And in my process of doing due diligence, I have decided to only base my thoughts and my words on what my direct experience is, with the caveat that we have a lot to learn. We barely tapped into it all. And the best way that we can learn is for those of us who are serious about wanting to know who we really are and what those crop circles are and what the messages are and who are those cosmos beings and what are they thinking and doing and how do they eat and sleep and do they go to the bathroom and how do they run those crafts? Is it telepathic? And since none of them are hostile and we're all still here and that kind of proves it, they're not coming, in other words, to take our ovaries and eat us and control us and steal our resources, they would have. This is a time when we have a chance to invite them in. And when you read the treaty, you'll see that it's about how we can provide enhanced intelligence and communication, observation, data sharing. And this will pave the way, a safe way for humans to not only enter the universes and to live peacefully and healthily on the planet, but to be able to answer these very deeply embedded questions in us that we know the answers exist to, but we don't really know what the answers are.
No, we don't know what the answers are, but what you're doing now is a step in the right direction. And I have to tell you something, Carol. Our boy Joe Biden from Delaware better come correct and remember what his conscience is.
Yeah.
Because he's really disappointed the both of us right now.
He sure is. Can you go shake that man? I don't. If I
wrote him, he doesn't want anything to do with me.
You know, I saw him at my girlfriend Marsha's daughter's wedding, and I walked up to him while he was eating his baked potato in a champagne glass with caviar on it and tried to lobby him. And he looked at my husband and me and said, I don't get involved with anything that I know I can't win. And my
good
husband
Lord.
Was fainted. So there's Joe Biden. I mean,
I've actually met him a couple times myself, too.
Yeah, it's political stuff. It's all based on economics, but it isn't really. That's what we say. It's based on an awareness. And the awareness now is to shift our consciousness into the fact that we can have peace on Earth and peace in space. And we can have peace on Earth by assuring ourselves that we will have peace in space.
Yes, we will. And I want to wrap this up and say, Carol, thank you so much. I bow to you and what you're doing. It's very important. And we just have a few seconds right now, so I'm going to take a minute to say I love you. Thank you for being here. Everyone, please feel free to join our Truth Connections page on Facebook and feel free to visit our truthconnections.wordpress.com for any links to our past guests or archive shows. Everything's right there. We even have a new library that is up and running now, so you can get everyone's books. But just thank everybody for being with us, and geez, we got to have you come back, Carol. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you so
yeah,
much.
Thank you.
Now we're going to play that song that you mentioned. If you want to say what their name is again, that would be great.
That's Pia Larsen in Denmark. She's just producing these songs for the treaty and for all of us, and this is Peace in Space and on Earth.
Thank you, Carol. Bless you.
Something happened
here. Hi, everyone. Tamara here. Just to remind you, us on Facebook, as well as subscribing to us on our YouTube channel. We'd love you to join us during live shows at blogtalkradio.com/truthconnection. And for information on upcoming shows, visit our website at truthconnections.wordpress.com. Thank you for your support, and never forget that the truth is reality and the connection is you.
Come on.